All right. We've
Okay.
got liftoff.
Wonderful. Okay, we got to change the other screen though. Let me get this right here. All right, show my other screen. And here we go. Come on, come on. Oops, let's get rid of that. All right, now we're making some headway. All right. Is everybody ready to go?
Yes.
Yep.
Yep, go ahead.
Good. All right. Well, let me just start with a little story here. A while back, I went to visit a pastor at his office, and I noticed on his door that it said that he was now pastor of spiritual formation. And so I commented on that and said I thought it was great that their church was training people formationally. And his comment to me was, "Well, that's what everyone seems to be calling it these days. You know, we used to call it discipleship, but that doesn't seem to do it for people anymore." Well, to make a long story short, I found that meeting somewhat disappointing. Because the first thing I want you to know is that Christian formation is not the new buzzword for discipleship. And in fact, there's a lot of ways that it differs fairly significantly from what we used to call discipleship training. Now, the last time I was on Joy Streams, I offered a metaphor of rowing versus sailing. And these are, of course, very two different ways to get around. They both require some effort, but the kind of effort and the kind of results we get, of course, are very different. And what we need to know up front is that Christian formation is truly as different from traditional models of discipleship as sailing is different from rowing. And so what I'm going to try to do today is summarize for you how these two approaches differ and what Christian formation is really about. Now, one of the main reasons that Christian formation is so different is that it begins with a focus that is quite different from most discipleship programs. In most of the Christian world, our teaching on the Christian life focuses on all the things we should do and all the things we should not do. And our training focuses on trying to get people to live up to this standard and adopt what we sometimes call a Christian lifestyle. Now, we even tell people that they may not feel like doing the right things, but they can't go on feelings, and that we should simply override any contrary feelings we have and do what's right anyway. Now, of course, to be clear, I agree fully that being ruled by our feelings would be a disastrous way to live. That's not the problem here. The problem is in trying to comply with rules that are at odds with our heart by using our will and forcing ourselves to act as if we are forgiving or loving our enemy or whatever. Okay? But there is a better way. Rather than trying to do what is good by sheer willpower, regardless of where our heart is, Christian formation aims at changing our heart and becoming the kind of person who does what is good because of where our heart is. Our intention is to change the character of the person so that the heart and mind are on the same page and we can live out of our renewed character instead of always trying to, say, override our heart in order to do what is right and good. And as most of you probably know, trying to get people to do things without first helping them have a change of heart is a great recipe for pastor burnout. See, traditional approaches to the Christian life are often based on the idea that if you try to do something long enough, your heart will eventually catch up. But the truth is, Paul says the exact opposite. He says if you try to do something long enough, you'll realize you can't do it and that you need God's help. In fact, he says if righteousness came from doing the right things, we would not have needed a new covenant. See, the Bible clearly states that life in the kingdom runs on the opposite assumption, that if you take care of the heart first, everything else will take care of itself. I mean, just look at these passages. First, remove the log that is in your own eye, and then you'll be able to see. Or, clean the inside of the cup, and the outside will be clean also. See, a good tree produces good fruit by its very nature. We see this in the whole Sermon on the Mount, where Jesus tells us that he wants more than just compliance with the law. He's looking for a change of heart. See, when we shift our focus away from trying hard and shift it towards an inner transformation, focusing on that, then this has a lot of implications for how we approach everything else about the Christian life. Look at this. The traditional approach to discipleship is all about doing stuff. We hear all these shoulds about what we should do and what we shouldn't do. We hear about getting involved in church and getting involved in ministry and doing outreach and starting programs and learning how to give. This is all very performance-driven. It's almost like behavior modification with Christian terminology. On the other hand, Christian formation focuses on character development, on developing a relationship with God that has enough substance to it and is vibrant enough to actually change us. It talks about relationship with others and what that looks like. It focuses on inner healing and cleaning up all those messy places in our lives. And transformation talks about all the different ways that we get involved with God that will transform who we are. See, this is a very development-focused approach to the Christian life. Now, to be clear, these differences aren't 1,000% mutually exclusive. You know, most discipleship programs will make some reference to what we would call formational elements. And formational training can include some traditional teaching. But what's different here is where we're placing our primary focus. And in fact, what the average person in our churches will come away with. And I think if we're honest, most people have a very performance-driven view of the Christian life. Now, before I give you a real concise definition of Christian formation, let me tell you what some of these underlying premises are of this whole approach to Christian living. First of all, spiritual formation is not optional. Okay, we're always being formed. We're always in the process of being formed for good or bad. It's absolutely inescapable. Everything we do, everything we feel, think, everything that happens to us, even some things that we miss that should have happened to us, all of these things are constantly forming us spiritually. Okay, now what we need to know, secondly, is that this formation does not happen by our direct effort. It's something that we catch, but we are totally involved in the process. See, we cannot directly reform our character by an act of the will, or by continually overriding our emotions. But we are involved in our formation, and that brings us to number three, which is we can choose how we're involved in the process. We have a great deal of latitude in terms of where we place our focus and what we make time for and how we proceed. And that leads us to an understanding of Christian formation that is this. It's about deliberately participating in the ways we are being formed so that our inner life, our inner being, becomes more like the character of Christ himself. All right? Now, let's break this down. How do we actually influence? How do we participate in the way we are formed? How does this all happen? Now, what we can do that will impact our life is this. We need to engage in a process of restoration and retraining within the context of an authentic relationship with God. Now that's a mouthful, and I'm going to go over these three areas a bit and break them down. But let me say that again. We need to engage in a process of restoration and retraining within the context of an authentic relationship with God. Now, one of the best ways to seek restoration, let's look at that first, is to learn how to engage in what we call Emmanuel prayer. I would imagine most of you who are listening are familiar with this approach to inner healing. And at the very heart of this process, we engage with God and ask him to speak directly into our heart and mind. And since his voice carries the power of life, amazing things can happen. He can reframe our story so that it becomes redemptive instead of hopeless. He can address our triggers and speak into our wounds and release us from bondage with just a word or a phrase. Now, the truth is we all have hundreds, if not thousands, of places in our soul that need God's light to see what he sees. And since we live from our heart, we all do, every time he restores something there, whether big or small, it changes how we live by our very nature. And the more we're restored, the more we will live as God intended. Now, that restoration, of course, has to take place within the context of this relationship I'm talking about. And in fact, what we call Emmanuel prayer is actually just one expression of what we would call an Emmanuel lifestyle. See, God not only wants to speak into the dark places and provide healing, he wants to walk alongside us all the time. This is part of what Jesus was talking about when he used the phrase, abiding in him. And we need to get, this isn't just a euphemism for, you know, God being with us. This is a practical reality, and we need to learn to talk to God all the time about everything and learn how to hear him speak into our life and mentor us. This is why we talk so much about conversational prayer. You know, Isaiah 55 says that God's voice is like food for our soul, and we need to learn how this relationship can actually feed us. And again, I want to emphasize that when we use the phrase relationship with God, this is not a euphemism for I've been saved. It means we have a functional relationship. We interact with him. We sense his presence with us. And we're actually getting to know him and not just know about him. There's a big difference. Now, in addition to living in relationship with God and being restored by him, we can also be formed by certain types of soul training. And this gets into the area of what we call spiritual practices. Now, there's three main kinds of training that I want to highlight here. The first is practicing something that's within our ability in ways that will eventually enable us to do something we could not have done by direct effort. This is a definition from Dallas Willard. We might call these soul training exercises. One I'm sure you're all familiar with is practicing appreciation. As we do this on a regular basis, we'll discover over time that our heart will go there quite naturally, even on days when things are not going very well. That's what we mean by being enabled to do something we could not have done by direct effort. You see, while we might be able to say things that sound like appreciation on a bad day, our heart will not necessarily join us unless we've previously developed a heart of appreciation through training. And if we had time, I could go on to explain how this is all very different from more traditional approaches like fake it till you make it. But we have to leave that for another discussion. We need to move on here. The second aspect of our training is that of deliberately making space for engaging with God on a regular basis. See, this is actually what makes the difference between a spiritual practice that is very life-giving and a practice that's dry and lifeless. Now, many of the standard spiritual practices, like reading the Bible or engaging in solitude or even fasting, if we do these things with the expectation that merely by doing them we're going to grow spiritually, we may be very seriously disappointed and even give up the practice. And I'm sure we're all familiar with the quiet time that has turned into drudgery. This is because many spiritual practices are primarily intended to make us space for engaging with God. They're not about doing something spiritual. It's engaging with God that changes us, not the practice itself. It's very important. And again, it would take more time to go into this distinction and explain the differences. But this is the nutshell. This is the view from 30,000 feet. So let's keep moving. The third way that we can do this. Besides the practices that exercise our soul and some practices that make a space for engaging with God, is there's some practices that help us to engage very directly with God in ways that allow Him to mentor us and feed our soul. And primarily these are various forms of conversational prayer, where we learn to hear God speak into our life and get to know Him from the ways in which He interacts with us. So if we restate our earlier description, maybe this will make more sense now. Christian formation is about engaging in a process of restoration and retraining within the context of an authentic relationship with God. And that's, of course, with the specific intention of allowing God to transform our character to become more like the character of Christ Himself. I hope this is starting to make some sense. Now, why does all this matter? The fact is that God wants a relationship with us, not an arrangement. Most of us were taught that the good news is we get to go to heaven when we die if we just admit that we're too sinful to get there on our own. And in exchange for that gift, we should try to live better. But I don't think that's really the gospel. I think the good news is that God wants us to be His children so that He can live with us and live in us and teach us how to live as He intended. And what Christian formation does is teach us how to be in relationship with God. Secondly, God wants to renew our heart, not merely encourage compliance. So I don't think the Christian life is about doing good things. It's about becoming a good person. And that's a very different process. And Christian formation shows us how to do that. And third, real change happens from the inside out and not the other way around. Most of our traditional teaching on the Christian life tries to motivate us to make good choices whether or not our heart is ever on board with this. On the other hand, Christian formation teaches us how to engage with God so that He can change our heart. We can then become that good tree that produces good fruit by its very nature. And I just think this is far more hopeful and far more life-giving approach to Christian growth. And to summarize this, I think why we need this: if we are going to actually grow and become more Christ-like, we have to stop trying to act like Jesus and instead focus on getting to know Jesus. Because only when the life of God is truly in us will we have any hope of that life coming out of us. And that's from my new book, Forming a Work of Grace. Again, it would be very hard to emphasize how huge this paradigm shift really is. But shifting our focus away from trying to do the right things and instead focusing on how to become the person God created us to be, this has huge implications for how we view almost everything else about the Christian life, including conversion, sanctification, evangelism, and so on. And that's why I've written this book on Christian formation. Now, frankly, there's a lot of other books on Christian formation out there, and I've read as many of them as I possibly can. And I've got a long list I could highly recommend. There's good stuff out there. But if I might speak frankly, I don't know of any single volume that is quite as comprehensive as this one regarding how all this works out in our practical theology. And we also, of course, have this course on Christian formation, because this isn't just about changing our theology, our practical theology. This is a very experiential process of learning how to engage with God. And most of us can only learn how to do this if someone else shows us how and walks us through the steps. And that's why we have this course. And frankly, we're getting wonderful, wonderful feedback. Even from Christians who've been in the church for decades and done everything they knew how to do under the old traditional approaches, there's absolutely no doubt that Christian formation is changing lives. Now, I hope this summary has been helpful in understanding what Christian formation really is and why it's different, how it's different from what most of us were taught about the Christian life growing up, especially if you've grown up in the church. And with that, of course, I'd like to give the floor back to Chris.
All right. Thank you, David. I really appreciate it. I'm going to turn on my webcam here and get my screen up because we're going to have some really good questions here. Wow, you've given us a lot to think about. So hopefully everybody can see my screen at this point. Let's just dive right in for the sake of time. So friends, as you listen to what David shared here on Christian formation, let's talk a little bit. Well, David, you might need to mute your headset there.
Okay.
We're getting some of that feedback. There we go. All right, so after listening to David on Christian formation, what concerns does it raise for you as a pastor when you think about what David shared with us? There's a lot to chew on here, but what comes to your mind is, are there any roadblocks, any concerns that you feel like will hinder you being able to apply this?
We actually had two people already type things in, and I'm trying to see if they can be unmuted. I'm going to start with Bill. Bill, are you still there? I'm going to unmute you. Bill?
Yeah, let me make sure. Can you hear me now?
Yes.
Yeah, there we go.
Okay.
You want me to read what you wrote?
yeah, that would be a good place to start.
Okay.
I've got a couple things going on here.
Yeah, the first thing he typed in was that he believes there's actually a rhythm between doing and being. It's like the rhythm of joy and rest. That both are required for life. Of course, ourselves, we can do nothing. Only doing is in him. So do you want to expand on that, Bill?
Yeah, one of the things that our ministry, my wife and I, what we're really involved in is the deeply wounded. And one of the things that we've learned through our own journey is that you really have to ask God pretty much about everything. And the Emmanuel lifestyle is pretty much the way to go. Mm. So the idea that, we can do something of our own efforts, you get burned pretty quick doing that when you try to do something that's over your head. And that's one of the good things, because then you're basically the formation, what it sounds like to me, is you're training yourself to depend on God. You know, what a good idea. You know, it really sounds like the way to go. So, yeah, this is really encouraging, and I believe that, the Holy Spirit is working on Christian believers all around the world to, learn to trust him.
Mm-hmm. Yes, thank you. That's good. And it's really encouraging, Bill, to hear that as you are being able to apply this and teach this to friends who are really severely wounded and severely broken, and the power of that Emmanuel lifestyle that David's talking about today.
Okay, I'm gonna read this from Keith. What he had said was, he says, I think what David is describing is not what I would think of as traditional, but more like the Western focus of mind that American and European churches have taught, the performance emphasis. The Christian formation to him sounds something like what he's been reading in Oswald Chambers. I think more like the older traditional perspective of the church fathers. Would you guys agree?
All right, David, anything you want to respond there?
Well, traditional is a relative term. For the last several hundred years, the Western world has been focusing on performance and education and motivating factors rather than character formation. And so from where we stand today, that's the tradition we live in. But I would agree with what you're saying, that the older tradition was much closer to where we're trying to head. This isn't anything brand new. We're trying to recover a lot that's been lost in recent generations.
And I particularly enjoy, David, the emphasis that you're giving us today on relationship and how so much comes out of the actual relationship with Christ. There's something really liberating about that and refreshing. So I hope people are feeling some of that.
Yep. All right, I have David Tenson has typed something in. Can I unmute you? Let me try that. I don't know if it'll work or not. David, are you there?
Yeah, I'm here.
Would you like to speak what you had written, or?
Yeah, sure. I'll read that out. I said, I believe the shifting out of a doing-based, or I guess many might call it a religious type approach to Reformation, may be one of the largest hurdles, you know, just making that shift. Do you have any suggestions, David, on initial steps or things to tackle as you commence the journey to, I guess, reforming, or even, you know, it sounds like it requires a whole new paradigm and approach to the way we see God, identify with God and others, and especially ourselves and our journey. Are there any initial things that you would tackle, or hurdles you'd jump to start off with?
Great question. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you for that. Yeah, I think the key is actually to start slow, and I would take the church leadership through this process first. You really need to have your senior pastor on board. You need to have your church leaders on board. They need to have some sense of be practicing conversational prayer themselves, get some inner healing. See, unless they've experienced this process themselves, there's no way you can teach it. And so you're going to have this from the top down. In fact, I think if you launch this from the bottom up, and the pastor hears about some, you know, subversive process going on in his congregation where they disagree with how he's preaching from the pulpit, this is just going to split the church up. So it's very important that you start with the leadership, and you walk them through it and help them understand that this isn't any condemnation on how they've been teaching, that this is the way they were trained too. And we've all been lost in this performance-driven paradigm. And we're just trying to recover what it means to be alive in Christ. And once they catch this, it's so life-giving. They'll want to train their people in it, and it'll just catch on like fire. But again, I would definitely be careful about how you introduce this, that you begin with the leadership.
That's very wise. Yeah, very wise.
Okay.
Yeah. All right.
Does anybody else that saw, look like Bill wanted to maybe talk again? You still have control on your mute button there.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah, I just wanted to agree that that was a strategy that when we prayed about it, that the Lord really encouraged us to start small, and it was with the leadership. And he was like, if you go slow and start small, you'll actually reap a greater reward. And so I just thank you. That's awesome to hear.
Great.
Okay,
thank
I've
you,
got
Bill.
A couple more well-typed out answers here. I still want to give them the chance to speak. Barbara Klicka, can I unmute you?
Oh, Barbara.
I'm here.
Would you like to read your comment?
Well, I guess I can do that. Thank you for the opportunity. I'm really delighted to hear what you said, and a couple of those screens were just excellent about the difference between discipleship, tradition, and this. I'm really glad to see that. I've been giving consideration to that lately. Have been working with a faith-based community for 13 years now, using these kinds of principles, the life model, thriving, and then moving into the Emmanuel model. Lately, I've been thinking more about how this transformation process might be experienced differently based on age and stage factors versus how do you engage 20-somethings into this formation process, and how you would engage people in the middle stages of life or toward the end, seeing how I've got one of those milestones coming up pretty quickly in my life. And I see a whole different aspect now. Eric Erickson jumped to mind, integrity versus despair, and thinking how we can encourage people in different stages into this process. Is that clear enough to get feedback?
Great question, Barb. David, you want to jump on in?
Yes. Yeah, absolutely. That's a wonderful question.
Hang on. I need Barbara, can you turn down your volume a little bit?
I'm getting some feedback here.
I couldn't make my VoIP headset work, so I'm just on the regular laptop.
Okay, then perhaps while we're speaking, she needs to mute. Yeah.
Where do I mute? Let's see.
the green
there
microphone.
All right, this is wonderful. I'm still getting the feedback. I'm sorry.
It's not. I don't.
I can't hear. If I hear myself, there. It's gone.
Yeah.
All right. Yes. The reason this is important is the different stages of life have radically different perspectives on what they need. I need to be very candid and say when I wrote Forming and designed the course, I did it from my own perspective, which is I was in my late 40s, having spent maybe close to 30 years searching for some kind of authenticity in the evangelical church. And I was pretty burnt out and fried and tired and worn out, and I'd done everything that you're supposed to do, and it didn't change anything. And so when I began to discover Christian formation and this Emmanuel lifestyle, it was like water to my soul. And what I wanted to do in writing Forming was to create a bridge for people who have been in the church a long time to make this huge paradigm shift away from performance and shame and all these other things into a life of grace and relationship and transformation. And so the Forming itself is really targeted at middle age, as best as I could. Now, that said, our experience has been in teaching the course, which is really just an introduction to Christian formation. That's really what the course is. We have seen just about everything from about 20 years old on up to 80 years old be dramatically impacted by this information. So it has a much broader appeal than we originally guessed, especially as effective to people who've been in the church for 30 years and are, you know, just long ago quit expecting any real character transformation. But one of the challenges for young people, I think, is I think by and large they've already lost faith in the older generation. And I think it might be helpful just to synchronize with them for starters and say, yeah, you know, we probably let you down. You know, the church has been teaching, and when I say the church, and the reason I, again, go back to this idea of traditional teaching, and I don't mean to belittle any organization. They've done some good things, but if I could list a few, we're talking about Navigators and Campus Crusade and YWAM, and these organizations have been teaching, quite frankly, a very performance-driven approach to the Christian life for decades. And these are the models that we have gone by. I would, frankly, I have to include Saddleback with this. And at the risk of offending someone. Wonderful, wonderful education. I think the best education program we've ever seen have come out of Saddleback, and I love their stuff. But it stops short of Christian formation. It doesn't teach people how to become different people. It teaches them how to do better things. And there's a huge difference. And so when we start talking to the young people, we need to say, look, you're right. There's some ways that the church has been full of hypocrisy. We've said things that we can't do, and you can see through the facades that are around you. But let's talk about maybe there's a better way. Maybe Jesus was talking about something else. Mm-hmm. And just synchronize with them and go right back to the heart of, you know, Jesus wants to grow you up, and this is what it looks like. So I think you can get to it either way. Whether it's through traditional organizations or kind of more of an informal approach with the younger people.
And what an opportunity, David, if I can jump in here, what an opportunity for healing with the younger generation, as we would acknowledge our own shortcomings and the ways that we've hurt the young generation. I see that really as what you're saying here could be very powerful for healing and open door.
Yeah. We need to just acknowledge that we've made some mistakes. I think it'll go a long ways.
Well, that's really good. I'm gonna jump in here just for the sake of time. We only have about 2 minutes left, and I've got A couple more questions here. I'm just going to quickly throw out.
Well, we started late because of my problem, so.
That's okay. No, that's okay. We could go on for hours on this stuff. There's so much here. This is so good. When we think about the three areas of relationship, restoration, retraining, which do you find most challenging to bring to your group? So I'm wondering if anybody had any thoughts on that, or if someone's had some successes in bringing true Christian formation to their congregation, their staff, their group. We have just a couple minutes left, but it'd be good to, if anyone has any thoughts on these questions, I want to give you an opportunity here to share anything.
Well, I'm not seeing new stuff. I still have other people that wanted to speak. Okay. Do you want me to go ahead and move with that?
Let's
all right.
Jump on in there. Yep.
Laura, I know you called in. Are you there?
Yes, I am.
Hi, Laura.
Hi there. Well, I had typed in a comment. The Lord allowed me a few decades ago to be involved in revival, and what I'm hearing here is essentially Galatians 2:20, that I am crucified with Christ, nevertheless I live, yet not I, but Christ lives in me. Mm. And the life which I now live in the flesh, I live by faith in the Son of God who loved me and gave himself for me.
Mm. Oh, that's good.
That's it in a nutshell. Wow. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. That's really good. Yeah. Thank you. Thank you. That's David, any thoughts to Laura's?
I think that's one of the passages that captures this really well. I appreciate your sharing that with us. Mm-hmm. There's a number of passages like that in the New Testament. And,
yes.
I just think that the challenge, though, is to see it with the eyes of heaven, because we've all read that passage from the old paradigm and thought we knew what it meant. But you're right on. Mm-hmm. That's a wonderful mm-hmm. way to encapsulate all of this.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yes. Well, it was almost like salvation. It was like the Lord just turned on the light bulb, and I've never been the same since.
Wow.
It does feel like scales falling off your eyes when you see it.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
That's all good. Right.
Thank you so much, Laura.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. So two other people are, it looks like they're kind of answering the second question you have there, and that is that for them, relationship is the most challenging for them. Barbara says so many previous experiences where spiritual authority was abused and people were harmed, so they're now skeptical. And then Daniel had something that was more personal, the verses toward the group, and he would like to speak. Do we have time?
Yes. Yep.
Okay.
We'll take.
Who was that? Daniel. This is who I met. Daniel Walter.
Daniel.
Are you there? Daniel.
Yes, I'm here.
Hi, Daniel.
Hi. Can you hear me?
Yep. We got you.
Great. Yeah, I had a question. I felt like when I was listening to David explain all that, I felt like that was right on. So I don't feel like, you know, that need convincing on that. What's more, I feel like I'm completely sold on it, and I'm, you know, trying to do that, I guess, for lack of a better way of expressing it. But I feel like sometimes I'm just like running up against a brick wall. That to use David's metaphor, I feel like I'm setting my sails, but not in the right way, or the wind's not there. You know, and I'm just kind of flapping in the breeze in some sense, or healing prayer sessions end in disappointment. And I end up falling back on, well, the thing that I know how to do, the thing that I can do is, you know, put forth effort and try, and I can get good results doing that. So I feel like I'm kind of oscillating between trying to, you know, kind of put myself, carve out that space for God, you know, use the spiritual disciplines as a way to just like sit in God's presence and let him mold me, to just kind of falling back on the old ways of, well, just put forth effort, at least I know I can accomplish something through that. So I don't know if you have a comment or advice for me on that.
Yeah, David, what do you think about that? I think Daniel gave us a good analogy here. He's putting up his sails and he's trying to catch that wind, and he's just feeling like he's kind of missing something there.
Yeah, well, you have a lot of company, Daniel. There's a lot of people that have that experience. And part of the challenge is that most of us don't have very many models to look at. We don't have people we can go to who are upstream from us in this process and can show us what to do. And that's where a lot of the challenge comes from. But let me just try to be encouraging here that, first of all, conversational prayer is actually much simpler than we would imagine, and we often stumble over the simplicity of it. And I would recommend the book I've written, Whispers of My Abba, because it's as best as I could possibly do. I mentor the reader on the written page, step by step, through what it's like to hear God. But if at all possible, what I would highly recommend is that you talk to your friends and anyone you know in ministry who has a good relationship with God. Find someone in your life who routinely has conversations with God and knows what this is like, and ask them to help you with it. Ask them to walk you through it. This is the best way. And I emphasize conversational prayer because I really believe that is foundational. It's very hard to build a relational approach to the Christian life if we can't talk to God and have conversations with Him. Imagine trying to have a relationship with a human being that you never see, you never talk to, you never hear from. You know, you send postcards one way, but you have no idea if they're being heard. So we really do need to discover the simplicity and the beauty of conversational prayer in order to move this whole thing forward.
That's helpful, David. That's helpful.
Yes.
Good.
It's been really helpful with the conversational prayer, for sure. One of the things that the verse that Jesus says, I've given you a power to overcome all the power of the enemy, I just seem that's been something that has really kind of disappeared from modern Christianity as well. And it seems like a lot of people who've had, a lot of possibly negative involvement of their ancestors with the enemy and things, that the enemy really needs to be dealt with in a more complete way. And we've been introduced to different ministries that do those things. And after that, then they were able to have the faith to hear. And we know it's a walk of faith, and that's what it really takes, is moving people from that fear-based walk to that faith-based walk, where they can take that step across so they're hearing more often. And the other aspect that comes up about the whole discipline, one of the things that the benefits I see from you, David, is you're coming from this background of being a disciple. You've really structured your life. You came through discipline as if it were the answer. What I find today with the youth especially is there's no discipline. when they jump into the Spirit of God, they're willing to listen, and they start to get into conversational prayer. And if they aren't taught how to test the spirits, they'll start listening to anything. And so what we found is a discipleship in the sense of becoming disciplined and applying yourself and being consistent with things is something that is like in a rhythm, like I was saying before. It's a rhythm of joy and rest, where you're focusing in.
And that's where I heartily recommend. I mean, there are some wonderful Christian education tools out there to complement Christian formation. And in our culture of biblical illiteracy, discernment is a huge problem. So, thank you for those comments.
Yeah. That's good. I'm gonna jump in here just because we're running out of time. This is so good. And David, I wanna let everybody know you're gonna be back. You're coming back in just a couple of weeks here on May 16th. You're going to talk to us about how to care for the pastor's soul, and this is another much-needed topic. I can't wait to have you back, David. This is just, I always feel like we're just scratching the surface. So I want to let everybody.
I'm looking forward to it. This is a huge problem.
We're going to have fun, and this is much.
Yeah,
needed.
Yeah.
So friends, next week on May 2nd at 12 o'clock Eastern Daylight Time, we have Kitty Wilder, who's our Track 2 trainer at Thrive. She's going to talk about returning to joy from negative emotions. You don't want to miss that one either. And then we're going to have Pastor Daryl Brazel back. He's going to talk about protecting Eve and how overwhelmed trauma and dishonesty hinders marriage joy. And Daryl touched on that last time. That's May 9th. Dave is going to be with us, as I said, May 16th. So mark your calendar. May 23rd, we have Jim Wilder back to talk a little bit about the Joy Starts Here movement that we're a part of. And then on the 6th of June, I'm going to talk to you. I want to hear some of your needs. I'm actually working on a pastor's book on starting joy and for pastors and leaders and your staff and your congregation and your family. And I want you to be, I want you all to help me write this book and give me your feedback. What do we as leaders and pastors need? What are our problems? So I'm really going to be looking to pick your brain a little bit on that day. David told us a little bit about some of his resources. I want to highlight these resources again. So much good stuff here. Truth About Lies, Lies About Truth, Whispers of My Abba, The Forming Materials. Please take a look at these resources. You can find them on the shopping page at lifemodel.org. So much good stuff there. Visit our new website if you're able, joystartshere.com. We have an interactive website up where we're really trying to help people engage more topics about joy and appreciation and all those good things. And in fact, Jim Wilder is going to be on the radio in just about 2 weeks. We'll release more information on that soon, but May 7th at 2 p.m. Eastern Time on station 1500 AM WQLV. TuneIn.com, you can find that station. He's going to talk about the Joy Starts Here materials, so I'd love to see you all. We're out of time. Denny, thank you for running this software. I'm glad it worked out for us. We never know what's going to happen with technology.
Yep.
And David, thank you again for being here with us. This has been so good, and I'm eager to hear more, and I suspect all of us are. So may the Lord bless you all, and have a good rest of the day, and we'll see you next time, hopefully next week.
All right, bye-bye.